sentencing aspect of the case, what, in your view, should the tagline be? How far would it be appropriate for us to unwind this?
For sentencing?
Yeah. Assume for the purpose of my question that the plea stands, but the issue is at the sentencing phase. How would we deal with that?
There were 8 duplicate robbery-related counts. One of those counts was attempted robbery, and it was made concurrent. So we're looking at 7 years of duplicate sentences. So this court would grant the habeas claim for sentencing conditionally on the state resentencing Mr. Cuevas to eliminate those duplicate counts. If I understand your question.
It does answer my question.
So the error of Mr. Cuevas' attorney is a textbook.
Well, I'll tell you what I don't understand. Here you negotiate a disposition for basically a term of imprisonment, which was, I don't know whether it was 35, 36 years, whatever it is. Okay. And as a matter of fact, if you look at the transcript, the judge said, I think I'll stick to the deal. I'll give him the maximum sentence. So the maximum sentence was what was negotiated in the plea agreement, roughly, or not quite, but roughly, because nobody seemed to understand what the maximum sentence is, because they couldn't figure it out. But it was around 35, 36 years. The way I computed it is if he now got the maximum sentence on the non-duplicative counts, it would be about a year less.
And under Glover, that would still be prejudicial. Under Glover's holding for ineffective assistance at the sentencing phase, the question
okay,
is...
It would be ineffective assistance because the court actually could go down to a lesser amount.
Right. And under Glover, any amount of actual jail time is prejudicial.
Even a year?
Even a year, yes. So in Glover, the range was 6 to 21 months. The Supreme Court found it prejudicial. And here we're looking at, under the state's position, a year and 4 months. Under petitioner's position, 7 years of difference.
But your argument is that in any event, he couldn't be resentenced to more than whatever the maximum sentence was at the time of the original sentence. Is that correct?
I believe that is correct.
Okay. So he couldn't be sentenced any more than 37, 36 years.
I think if he was sentenced consecutively as opposed to concurrently for the kidnapping charges, then we would end up with 1 year and 4 months less.
Right. Okay. Got it. And really your argument about a new trial to abrogate the entire agreement, I mean, he would be arguably in some jeopardy under that, wouldn't he? Considerable jeopardy.
He certainly would, yes, that's right. Mr. Cuevas is aware of that, and he, as he has from the beginning of his appeals and his habeas petitions, he would like to proceed to trial. That's supported by the declarations of his family and of himself. And I'm happy to touch on prejudice for the plea stage, which I agree is a higher hurdle for Mr. Cuevas to meet. He has to show that, but for his attorney's ineffectiveness, he would have rejected the plea and proceeded to trial. Now, in this case, there are essentially 2 benefits that Mr. Cuevas received from the plea. The first being a reduction from aggravated kidnapping to simple kidnapping, and then the second, eliminating the firearm enhancements.
But basically, by pleading, even with the erroneous sentencing that occurred, he got a lot less time than he was exposed to, or what he can be exposed to. So I guess I just find it somewhat implausible, let alone a reasonable probability, that he actually would have gone to trial in lieu of making a plea bargain of some kind.
Yeah, so let me talk about the actual impact of the plea. So, taking the firearm enhancements. Under California law, a firearm
kidnapping, there were two kidnapping charges, and one of them was plausibly. The question is, when did the intent to rob occur? Did it occur prior to the kidnapping so that it was kidnapping with intent to rob, or did it occur subsequently? If it occurred prior, then it's that is a kidnapping charge. And there was a dispute as to that, right?
Sure.
Yes. And so he could lose that dispute. And if he lost that dispute, that could be life imprisonment.
That's correct. It's a 7-to-life sentence, which would make him eligible for.
So you don't see, I think he'd have to have some degree of insanity to want to go to trial at this point. Especially, I mean, you saw what he said in his colloquy. In his sentencing colloquy, he apologized to all of those victims. He explained that it was the drugs that were involved. And so he doesn't really deny for, I don't know, 35 counts, maybe 20 of them. He doesn't deny that he was the perpetrator of the offense. I'd say this is a mistaken case of, or a case of mistaken identity. I just find it implausible, as Judge Graber points out, it's somewhat implausible to think that people want to go to trial now.
That is Mr. Graber's position, and it's been that from the beginning, Your Honor. But I certainly understand your point. I think if you compare Mr. Graber's potential sentence at trial with those risks, but with potentially the rewards of not being found guilty on some of the counts, compare that to the amount of jail time he would have received and his possibility of parole had he been convicted on all charges at trial versus the actual sentence he received and when he'd be eligible for parole under that sentence. The difference is not so dramatic, but there's not a reasonable probability. And I think when you combine that with other aspects like the special circumstances set forth in the declarations by his family and by Mr. Cuevas, if you also look at the state's position, where they, when they're discussing in the sentencing context, but they're applying the standard for ineffective assistance at the plea stage, they say the state would have rejected this deal if it weren't for those duplicate robbery counts. And so I think it's certainly reasonable that Mr. Cuevas would have also rejected the deal in those circumstances.
It's hard to know who would reject the deal, given the fact that, I mean, at some point people might say, well, you know, 35 years is enough. I don't know to what extent the state was interested in 42 years or 49 years or something. It's either some marginal utility or disutility in trying to get the top number that you can get, I would think. Pretty speculative, isn't it?
So maybe I can touch on sentencing and cover those issues as well. So the state raises several issues on sentencing. The first is that Dari actually did not hold that Strickland was clearly established for Mr. Cuevas' claim. In the Dari case, the effective date, if you will, for when Strickland was clearly established is the same in terms of the Glover and Lafler analysis as Mr. Cuevas' claim. So
right, because in that case, the state court ruled post-Glover and pre-Lafler, just as here.
Correct. So to the extent that there was any ambiguity in the en banc court's use of the word and when it was discussing Glover and Lafler, when that case was returned to the three-judge panel held very clearly that Strickland was clearly established for Dari's claim in that case, and therefore it would also be clearly established for Mr. Cuevas' claim here, which is in that same after Glover but before Lafler position. The state also raises a series of other arguments related to the sentencing phase. And each of these seems to be slight variations on the idea that Mr. Cuevas' attorney had no duty to do anything that would jeopardize the plea. And it looks like what the state is practically doing is taking the ineffective assistance standard for prejudice at the plea stage and imposing it on the deficient performance prong of Strickland when it comes to ineffective assistance to sentencing. And if this is done, it would essentially close off ineffective assistance of sentencing for any person who has pled guilty. And we don't believe that's the right result here. Any person that's pled guilty. In other words, anytime there's a guilty plea, if you had to meet the standards set forth by the state in their positions, you would have to meet the plea from the plea standard for prejudice at both sentencing and the plea stage. touch on the new argument that's raised for the first time by the state in this appeal. This is the argument that Mr. Cuevas could have been charged with additional crimes that were not in the information. And we've set forth our reasons why we believe that argument's been waived. But I first want to just go through, assuming that it is accepted by this court, and talk about why we don't believe it's appropriate here. To begin with, the state's position is that California Penal Code Section 1009 allows the amendment of the information at any time. And although the statute reads in that manner, the state has not cited any case.
Isn't the argument a simple argument? So the state is always going to say they can charge something else. I mean, there's always something else involved, in, especially a series of 37 robberies. So I'm sure there are all sorts of things you could charge, but you're not tasked with the responsibility of trying to figure out what could be charged by an aggressive prosecutor. I agree with your argument at this. I'd like to hear what the state has to say about that.
You have less than 3 minutes left. Do you want to save it for rebuttal?
I would. Thank you.
Good afternoon, and may it please the court. My name is David Gleisman. I represent the respondent. I will try to focus on the questions the court has directed. In order to do that, and to reframe the case from our perspective, I would point out that when we're talking in this case about the evaluation the lawyer was required to make and what evaluation a court makes of that in hindsight under Strickland and under Primo versus Moore, the Supreme Court is very clear that we look at the case from the lawyer's perspective at the time. Now, we have acknowledged the 8 duplicate counts. I would ask the court, if the court looks, for example, at page 303 and 304 of the supplemental excerpts, you see the array of charges that this defendant faced. And trial counsel was aware of that. And the petitioner's argument seems to be, in many respects, that we freeze the case and only evaluate, for example, his comparison of the agreed upon disposition versus the ultimate result. Once you eliminate the 8 counts, that's a very narrow ruling.
Well, I understand your argument as it relates to the plea stage, because with that, as you call it, an array of many charges with heavy penalties, as I indicated earlier in my questions to opposing counsel, I find it difficult to think that a different decision would have been reached on whether to plead. But once it reached the sentencing phase, had a competent lawyer looked at this and said to the sentencing court, there are 8 counts here that you are not legally entitled to sentence this person on. And I can't imagine that a court would say, oh, I don't care, I think I'll go ahead and sentence him anyway, even though these are not valid charges. That wouldn't happen. So something different would have happened at sentencing, wouldn't it?
Well, a couple things, Judge Graber. First of all, with respect to the erroneous counts, what happened there, to be clear, and I think Judge Breyer's comment touched upon this, this was a disposition to a term of years. 37 years, 8 months, as the parties calculated it, 2 years less, as the judge did. If you look at the page that I noted, with every 10-year weapons enhancement identified, this defendant is facing exponentially more time than that.
Right, that has to do with whether to plead.
So, once the decision to plead has been made, and if the court has determined that counsel is not ineffective in obtaining a plea arrangement that is potentially saves 2 life terms plus something that could be in excess of 100 years of mandatory time. Once we get to now the sentencing phase, the difficulty is as follows. Their position is that at the time of the plea, the parties would inform the court, we have a deal or we have a proposed agreement. By the way, it's not an open plea as California calls it. It's a maximum, what's called a lid. We have an agreement subject to the court's evaluation. It's contemplated, as was indicated, the court wants to sentence to the maximum, I think because of the radical reduction in time.
Well, I know it was contemplated that way. It was contemplated that the court, that the court would impose a sentence not greater than the maximum, but that the defense, and it said in the plea agreement, that the defense could make its pitch to get a lower sentence. That's what was contemplated. And what was contemplated was that the district attorney agreed that based upon the conduct, not just the conduct charge, but the conduct, an appropriate sentence, or one that the district attorney was willing to live with, was, I don't know, was it 37 years or whatever it was at the statutory max,
right,
given particular situation. That's what we know. What we don't know is what really went on in the judge's mind at sentencing after listening to all the arguments, other than that the statutory maximum was X, and he thought whatever it was, because apparently nobody can figure it out, and the prosecutor can't figure it out, apparently, that statutory maximum was X, and that was a satisfactory resolution from the court's point of view.
Your Honor, I would ask you to also consider, because it is explicitly stated by the sentencing judge, when the judge tells the petitioner more than once the extraordinary deal that he's getting and that he should be great.
I don't disagree with that for a moment. I mean, that's why I can't possibly accept the representation that he wants to have a new trial and everything that contemplates. I mean, I think that may be what the petitioner wants, that maybe he has to be safe from himself in these circumstances. But I'd like to ask you a different question, which is this. If it went back for resentencing, do you agree, in resentencing on those counts that are actually crimes, rather than a robbery is an event that occurs, that you can rob a store?
Yes.
I didn't even know that you could rob a store, that you have to rob people. Okay, but assuming that you now have the crimes in mind and the appropriate crimes, do you agree that the limitation of the sentence would be the sentence that was in, that is the top limitation, was what the court imposed in this particular case?
I do not, and I will explain why. First of all, in this case, the argument, and I think it's been acknowledged, certainly by not arguing to the contrary by the petitioner, is that he is seeking to have this agreement set aside. There is no entitlement that he has that I am aware of or that he has cited.
Well, let's assume we don't agree with that.
That's the plea agreement piece of it. I think that Judge Breyer and I are both trying to get at the same thing,
yes,
and that is to get both of you to assume, for the sake of these questions, that the plea agreement will not be undone for ineffective assistance, but that the lawyer acting competently would have figured out that eight of these were not crimes that he was being sentenced for. So what is the right answer? What's the right tagline for that?
I think this is the answer, Your Honor. I know this was basically your earlier point, and that is that, as I was saying, so the plea agreement has been obtained. Now, at that point, we are to believe, apparently, if I understand how this would have played out, that the defense lawyer would then inform the prosecutor, notwithstanding the agreement that they made, notwithstanding the almost inexplicable loss by the prosecution of so much exposure in a case where he is caught literally with all of this material, the defense lawyer, for purposes of sentencing, we are, I guess, are to believe, is going to say, Your Honor, I got them. They agreed to a plea to a term of years or a potential term, unaware that the plea is partially invalid. I would submit to you, and I think your experience, I would submit to you that in that circumstance, two things are likely to happen or would have happened and will potentially be resolved in the future in this case. And that is, the prosecutor takes the position that she has been sandbagged by the defense lawyer. They've agreed to a term of years, which is only a windfall to the defense in this case.
Well, not only a windfall, because he's being sentenced for eight things that aren't crimes at all. So why is that a windfall to him?
Because he's not being sentenced for a couple of dozen mandatory gun use allegations. He's not being sentenced for other crimes. But
wait. The gun charge, whether it was a BB gun or something else, that's all up in the air. This is what I don't understand.
Yes.
You say, look, it can go back. and essentially the sky or the penal code is the limit, which, where I come from, there's this thing called vindictive prosecution, which means because somebody exercises their right to appeal, and if they're successful in their right to appeal, such as this case, you can't go back and then give him a more severe sentence than that which he received prior to the time that he filed his notice of appeal.
2 points, Judge Breyer. First, it has not been alleged in this case by this petitioner prospectively that the prosecution is barred from doing what I think cases in the plea bargain context recognize, which is that in 2003, the parties came to an understanding about an appropriate term of years. If that is undone, and as a result of that, a trial...
You could have the same number of years, counsel. I'm not saying that if it's 36 years, you could still, conceivably, couldn't you, if you ran things consecutive to some extent, could you be up there? Close to it, right? Within a year.
Or far beyond it. And I think that there are...
How do you get there? You're getting there only by adding more crimes in that he's being sentenced for. And I think that's Judge Breyer's question to you.
If you truly set aside the plea...
So what if you set aside only the sentence? That's been the premise of the questions. Set aside the sentence.
Because...
I've been listening now for 20 minutes. You've been asked the same question many times by our colleagues, and you just don't answer it. Just for what it's worth, I'm sitting here listening, and you keep saying, you know, I don't know if it's third base or something like that. Do you understand the question?
I do understand.
We're not setting aside the plea agreement.
I understand.
Okay, and now it's sentencing, and the lawyer says, Your Honor, you're about to sentence my client on 8 counts that are not crimes.
And at that point...
And at that point, what happens?
At that point, the judge, as I said, the prosecutor may say, we want to seek to be relieved of this plea. We discussed the term of years. We're not getting it. Alternatively, the judge may say, the terms of this agreement are no longer valid because they have not agreed on a term or on a maximum. The defense has in mind a strategy of undermining a basic component of the plea.
The defense lawyer says, no, Your Honor, we have a deal. I oppose setting aside the plea. I insist on a sentence on the lawful counts. What we're objecting to is having my client sentenced to lawful counts. I mean, it just doesn't happen because the prosecutor says, I went out of the deal because I did a dumb thing. And then you don't get out of the deal that way, right? You don't get out of the deal for having a dumb, having made a bad decision as a defense lawyer. So why should the prosecution get out of that? Why can't the defense lawyer say, no, we want a sentence, we just want a sentence on the lawful counts.
For the same reason, Judge, because this guy submitted that if the prosecutor had said at the same point, just a moment, we didn't calculate additional exposure, the judge would say, I'm not going to enforce a deal that was other than what the parties contemplated if one party is...
That's not my experience. Deals get enforced against defendants all the time, even though they have... What authority do you have for the proposition that the trial court would simply have said, I'm setting aside the deal now? Is there any authority for that?
Just the basic proposition that the deal is no longer a deal. The deal was to plead.
Why wouldn't the judge say, you're a lawyer, madam prosecutor, you're a lawyer, this is the deal you cut. You've included some sentences that are crimes. I can't consider them. That was your bad. And you need to report this to your supervisor and report that you did a bad job. But that's not a mind concern. Why wouldn't the judge say that? They said that to the defense lawyers all the time.
I suppose the judge might say that. The government then may attempt to appeal that decision to a state court. I don't know, but I think
the error. I think the error actually is the prosecutor's error. I can't believe that a prosecutor would have thought in filing these charges that you could rob that a victim of a robbery can be a store, but maybe the bar has changed since you want to talk about something ineffective. That strikes me as being a little odd. Anyway, when the deal was made,
yes,
the prosecutor knew a couple of things. He knew that there were a gun used, whatever that gun was. He knew that there were 30 or 28 or 35 robberies, whatever those were. He knew what the loss was, right? He had all of that information, and he knew the circumstances of the, quote, kidnapping, right?
Correct.
At that point, the prosecutor decided that 35 years or whatever it is, 34 years, 4 months, or 35 years, was the appropriate punishment. And so now if it goes back to seek a punishment greater than that, would appear, at least to me, to be vindictive, because you are punishing him not based upon new evidence. You are punishing him because of what he did. He appealed it. He appealed it because the prosecutor alleged crimes that weren't crimes.
And my time is running out. What I would reply with is the contrary to that would be that if, as the court indicates, if there is a perception that this is worth approximately 37 years or 36 years, and that is counter to what the defense is intending to do with the case, then it seems to me it's also conceivable that the plea is set aside. My time is up. Thank you.
Just to respond and answer one of the questions that was posed, the state has cited no case where the information was amended after the plea. They've also cited no case where a plea agreement was set aside after the plea was made. So I don't think that there is a precedent for that, at least in the briefing put forward by the state. We've discussed those cases and their holdings in our reply. Also note that the idea that the maximum sentence was precisely what was being sought in this case isn't supported by what happened when Mr. Cuevas was sentenced. So we've talked about how initially it was 37 years and 8 months. Then the judge went through, went sentencing, and got to 36 years and 2 months. And the prosecutor said that's enough. That was a year and a half less of time. And after the sentencing hearing, not sure why, but the attempted robbery count, one of the duplicative counts, was changed from consecutive to concurrent, meaning it reduced a sentence. And that took us down another 6 months to 35 years and 8 months, and that's the sentence that should
be. So what is the remedy you seek here? So you don't rule in favor of your client on setting aside the plea?
We would ask that Mr. Cuevas be resentenced.
Excuse me?
Be resentenced.
So, we can't resentence, obviously, in the district court. So, this would be a conditional writ. Would you say what?
Conditional on Mr. Cuevas being resentenced to remove the duplicative counts.
So, what this would mean is he would go before a superior court judge.
Yes, I believe that's right.
And what would happen at that hearing? Could the state then make the argument that Mr. Glassman might say, we went out of this deal because we entered it on a mistake?
They could make that argument. I haven't seen any case where it's been accepted and where it's happened. So I think they could try, but I don't think it would be successful.
Well, doesn't that depend on what kind of conditions we place on the writ if we issue one? I mean, one option is to just not give any instruction and let the state court figure out this question of whether mutual mistake of law gets them anywhere, and another is to say resentence on the counts that are in the plea agreement without these aid, and those are two very different scenarios.
Which is why I asked my question.
I understand. And you would prefer the latter? We would, yes.
I mean, I didn't ask you specifically for that, so I'm on. It It sounded to me like you were asking more like the kind of thing that you were telling me you were asking for, but now you're telling me you're really asking for what Judge Gray was suggesting.
Yes, sorry if I misspoke or misunderstood.
I'm not blaming you. I'm just clarifying the record.
So, yeah, we are asking that the duplicate sentences be removed. Don't believe
me. And then you give your sentences on the lawful counts, period.
That's right, yes.
Okay. Thank you. Case is argued, stand submitted.